lobs it in the air. Oh, what a catch, Gary Jennings. And you know Dana Holgorsen is going for two. Greer, quarterback run. He got it. Two-point conversion for West Virginia. And the Mountaineers defeat the Longhorns 42-41.
Last week, this is this week, as the Mountaineers take the field, ranked number 9th in the country, as they will host the TCU Horned Frogs on a lovely Saturday afternoon here in Morgantown. A look at the Big 12 standings, and you can see how much these teams have to play for. West Virginia and Oklahoma essentially control their own destiny as they enter and are in this month of November. And hello there, everybody. Justin Kutcher alongside DeMarco Murray and Petros Papadakis. DeMarco, it was a great game last week in Austin. West Virginia is hoping to do the same thing again here today. If they will, it'll be their dynamic duo, Will Greer and David Sills.
The most dynamic duo in college football. These two have their own secret language, and the coaches allow them to do what they do best. That's score touchdowns. 11 touchdowns this season, 29 dating back to 2017. These two are best friends on and off the field, but they have a great feel for each other. And sometimes it's a hand signal, sometimes it's as simple as an eyebrow. Watch these two as they get closer to the red zone. They're going to find each other. They're going to connect.
And watch these two next year as they'll be playing on Sunday. For TCU, Petros, it's a team that's been decimated by injury, but somehow they seem to be in all their games, and they have a player on offense who could be a game breaker, and that's Jalen Reagor.
Yeah, he has really carried the offense. This is a defensive football team, but Reagor stretches the field and does a great job taking the top off of defenses, and they need it desperately. The last four games, he has had touchdowns. Last week against Kansas State, 50-yard plus touchdown. Beautiful, strong receiver who's going to have a big day if the Horned Frogs are going to keep up in Morgantown.
For more on this game, let's go downstairs and check in with a fourth member of our crew, Holly Saunders.
Thank you very much, Justin. Good afternoon. Well, TCU needs to win two of its last three games in order to become bowl eligible, and this will not be an easy task. Head coach Gary Patterson told us yesterday the main objective today is to make Will Greer uncomfortable. Throw something at him that he has never seen before, something that makes him squirm, guys. Now, as for West Virginia, the honeymoon period from that Texas win, it is over. According to defensive coordinator Tony Gibson, the defense was actually irritated with the way they played last week. They were not happy at all. So they have something to prove today. You can expect pressure early and often from this young TCU quarterback. Justin?
Thank you very much, Holly. You can see Tony Gibson right there. TCU won the toss. They have deferred, which means West Virginia will receive. It is a chilly Saturday afternoon now here in Morgantown. There was snow earlier this morning, but they have come out in full force here at Milan Puskar Stadium. TCU in white, West Virginia in blue. Bunce will kick off for TCU. Back deep is Tevin Bush for the Mountaineers. And the wind is blowing here in Morgantown. And with that, the ball gets blown off the tee.
I know it looks like the sun is out, but man, is it cold here.
Football weather, boys. Football weather. I'm the only one with no jacket and no gloves on, man. I feel like I should be down there on the sidelines next to the heaters.
Take off your sleeves.
I think it says that one of us here is smart. The short kick. A really short kick. It's covered up at the 26-yard line. And that was a dangerous ball right there. But it looked like Josh Norwood was the one to cover it up for West Virginia. And as West Virginia comes onto the field, what should we be watching for?
Gary Jennings Jr., big play receiver, 149 career receptions. He's kind of the second tandem on that offensive side, but he's a little banged up. We're going to have to keep an eye on that ankle. On the other side, Collier and Bonagu. These guys have to harass the quarterback all day long and get in Greer's face. Don't let him be comfortable in that pocket.
T.J. Simmons goes in motion on first down. The handoff is to Kennedy McCoy, and McCoy gets a yard. That's it.
Well, you just heard Holly talk about it. Want to do something to make Will Grier uncomfortable. Want to make him squirm. Gary Patterson knows how to do this, and they have the edge rushers to do it.
Here is Grier. His first pass attempt is incomplete for David Sills across the middle. So now it's third and long. Grier, last week at Texas, big numbers, 28 of 42, 346, the three touchdowns, but of course the two-point conversion that won the game for West Virginia on the road.
Talking with Dana, they said they would have went for that two-point conversion because they have a great quarterback and they want the ball in his hands. They knew that he was going to convert that two-point conversion last week.
On third and nine, Grier with time over the middle. He completes it to Sills, but Sills is going to be short of the first down marker. So that's going to force a three and out here on the opening series.
You're going to see Sills get open across the middle by coming back to the football, way back to the football. That took him out of the first down. Nice three and out by the Horned Frogs to start this game.
So Billy Kinney will come on to punt Jalen Reagor. Dangerous as the return man. That is the exact start that TCU was hoping for on the road. A good punt, fair catch. That is made at the 21-yard line by Reagor. So TCU will take over on offense after a 45-yard punt. And Petros, what should we watch for when TCU has the ball?
Well, the quarterback right now is Michael Collins, a transfer from Penn. And he put on a show on the scout team last year, but he's going to have to weather that storm. Tony Gibson's going to bring a lot of pressure against this young quarterback, just a sophomore. And on the other side for West Virginia, the guy that holds everybody accountable, the leader of the defense, David Long. Dana Holgorsen told us he makes every tackle. I don't know how he can get any better. Guy's a great player and a great leader here in Morgantown.
Look for this defense to add a lot of pressure to Collins and getting him off his rhythm a little bit.
On first down, the handoff is to Darius Anderson. And Anderson gets tackled by Torius Avery after a pickup of six for number six.
He's having a solid year after losing four offensive linemen a year ago to the NFL. He hasn't seen those big, long, explosive runs, but he's having a solid year, averaging 5.1 yards a carry. But if they want to have a chance, they have to control that West Virginia defensive front and allow him to get going.
Second down and four. They give it to him again. A patient run, gets outside, lowers that shoulder, and he will get the first down. Picks up five, tackled by Josh Norwood.
Violent hit on the edge there by Josh Norwood, but a good job of pressing the line of scrimmage and then jumping outside by Anderson. TCU looks pretty calm to start this game.
Looked really good on defense. Now they get a first down here, move the chains.
Here comes that pressure that we're talking about. Coach Gibson wants to do this all day long.
And we've got our first flag of the day. A false start coming up. Our referee is Brandon Cruz.
5-yard penalty. It's first down.
That's against Austin Myers.
Just when I said they were calm to start.
The announcer jinx is in effect. Now, you might be saying, wow, Mike Collins, short sleeves from Texas. No, he's actually from Connecticut, so maybe he's used to the cold weather.
Used to be a Penn Quaker and then wanted to play at a higher level after a year.
And now Collins, he's going to run with it. And Collins will get tackled at the 31-yard line. Giovanni Stewart stops him after a pickup of four.
Thought he took off a little early there.
Well, that was a good job by West Virginia defense. It's the RPO that you're accustomed to seeing now in college football. The run wasn't there. He was looking to throw the bubble outside, but the cornerback played that well and forced him to keep the ball in his hands and get 2 or 3 yards there.
Third start of the season for Collins, 6'5", 225 pounds. Second down and 11. Collins, his first pass, that is complete to Reagor. And Rager's going to be about a yard or two shy of that first down marker, so third and short coming up.
We just talked about Jalen Reagor, strong guy, 5'11", 195 pounds, had a Waxahachie, Texas, just a sophomore, but good job establishing him early by Collins, stepping up in the pocket and making a solid throw. This is a big short yardage play.
It will be third and one. That fan has to be called. It's kept by Collins, and Collins thought about sliding, and it looks like they're going to say his knee was down. He's going to get three. Kenny Robinson came up.
Collins, great job. He's not the most mobile guy, but you have to respect his legs. Here you just see it's a read option, and that defensive end crashes. Great job by the offensive line, washing the defensive line down, making it a very easy, simple read for Collins to get that first down.
He is lucky he did not get hurt. You don't slide and then pop back up. Everything about that play was awkward, but it worked well, and he was able to get the first down, and TCU's still on the field.
Two first downs on the drive for the Horned Frogs. Play action, shot down the field, and it's caught by Rager. The big play receiver makes a big play here in the opening quarter against Kenny Robinson, gets 35.
Well, that quieted him down here at Milan Pushkar, but watch where Collins throws this ball, allowing Rager to come to it and really come open.
Yeah, just on that outside, they're playing cover two. You want to force him outside rather than inside. If you give him that right away, it's an easy throw, and Collins puts it right on the money. You have to put it in between that cornerback and in between that safety and make sure none of those guys can get in the way of that throw. He did a great job putting on the money there.
Confident throw.
The defense want to make a statement. Right now, it's TCU's offense that's making a statement as Anderson makes a nice move to pick up six. Second down and four coming up.
Anderson with the stop and go. I mean, this guy is, and he can run inside zone, he can run outside zone. He's seen, just froze Stewart there, and that's what you want to do as a running back. You want to freeze their legs and get upfield. He does an excellent job stopping and going and getting up north and south.
Let's not forget, Darius Anderson had 154 rushing yards against Ohio State back on September 15th, so you know he can put up some big numbers.
They just need to give him the opportunities, and like I said, this offensive line, they protected the quarterback well, but they have to open up more running holes.
Collins keeps it, and now Wisely goes down. Kenny Robinson was coming to lay the wood on him, third and coming up. And this is a big moment right now for both teams. I think it's a bigger moment, really, for TCU if they can convert here to extend the drive as opposed to having to kick a field goal.
They came out playing very well. Three and out, now they're driving the ball. Sonny Cumbie looked like he had a really good plan, the offensive coordinator for Michael Collins, to start this game.
Third and two from the 13. Collins rolling out to his right. Collins throws to the end zone off the fingertips of Rager.
Dangerous throw by the quarterback, Michael Collins, and Rager still almost came up with it.
Yeah, you just kind of want to throw this away. The call, I would have liked to see them keep it on the ground with Darius, or give me another route. When you sprint out, you condense the field going into the boundary, so you want to give him time, but you have to be careful in the red zone, not get a turnover. But great first drive by TCU offense.
It's going to be a 30-yard field goal attempt for Jonathan Song, and Song's kick is good. So a good three and out forced by the defense. An opening drive leads to three for TCU. FS1 College Football is sponsored by Dave & Buster's. Eat, drink, play, and watch sports. First quarter here in Morgantown, 3-0 TCU. First time this year that West Virginia has not scored first. How about that?
That's wow. Huge. That's huge for this TCU defense. But this TCU defense is one of the best in the Big 12. They have made each opponent not get those yards as an offense, so they're going to give them all they can handle.
Tevin Bush from the 9-yard line gets to the outside, and he gets shoved out of bounds at the 33. And he gets shoved out by the kicker, Cole Bunce. So let's see how West Virginia responds, because We've spoken with Dana Holgorsen. We've spoken with Tony Gibson. And Tony Gibson felt like it's the defense that sets the tone sometimes for this team. When the offense comes out and they're humming, sometimes you get kind of lackadaisical, lazy, like, oh, Will's going to do the job today. Well, now let's see if Will picks up the defense. On first down, it's Kennedy McCoy who gets a yard, so this drive starts like the last drive did.
And that is one way to get Will going, to establish the run game and really loosen things up for Greer to start working his magic. They ran the ball very well last week in Austin.
Greer gets rid of it to his tight end, Wesco. And Wesco takes it up to the 36-yard line.
Despite all the injuries, this is a stingy defense running the ball and passing the ball. So Coach Patterson is going to have these guys ready to play, and they're going to be in the right situations. They're going to be in the right areas at all times.
Third down and six. Greer with an open pocket finds Sills. Sills down the middle of the field, takes it across the 40. Juwan Johnson makes the tackle, but a 24-yard pickup, and West Virginia is going quickly.
And that's what they want to do. They want this dynamic duo, Sills and Greer. This is what they want. They want the ball in those two hands to get this offense moving.
Greer to his left. Now he's going to throw this one away. And that's a good heads-up play by Will Greer as the pressure was coming.
A lot of arm strength going backwards, able to throw that ball away. And Will Greer is a confident thrower, but to me it seems like he throws harder and harder every year as his arm becomes more and more talented.
Maybe it's the strength of fatherhood.
It might be dad strength, that's what they call it.
Eloise, his daughter. Second down and 10. McCoy goes out, empty backfield now for the Mountaineers. And that's a drop ball by TJ Simmons. You can't throw it any better.
It's cold out there, transfer from Alabama. We could hear it come off his hands way up in the booth.
Will Greer, you look at what he has done just this year. The only quarterback to be top seven in all five categories. Impressive stuff for this Heisman candidate. On third and 10, the draw play, and that's sniffed out. Juwan Johnson, the grad transfer from Northern Illinois. It's going to be a loss of two on the play. Third tackle of the game already for Johnson.
Good mix up. They're dropping eight, and you see Juwan Johnson just staying there. No one's blocking. They're trying to run a draw, but he's been playing extremely well. 10 tackles a week ago, and this is a great guy. He can cover. He can play the run game, but he's so athletic, and they are
on to punt for the second time. Jalen Rager back at his own 7-yard line. Let's see, is this going to be a touchback?
No, I don't think. I think Sills' foot may have touched the end zone there.
He's got great body control either way.
The officials are getting together to talk about this.
I think that right leg may have gotten in there, but West Virginia's hoping that it didn't.
Remember, it's all about the ball. If the ball goes over, it's Sills, a gunner, out there on the punt team making it happen.
Really on the field as a kicking team player controlled the ball in the field of play. Ball will be placed at the 1-yard line. First down, TCU. Timeout on the...
That is a huge, huge play by David Sills. Let's take a look at it right here.
Maybe that foot was down, but was the ball over?
FS1 College Football is sponsored by Farmers Insurance. Find an agent at farmers.com. Yes, please give me some warm chili. That would be fantastic right now. It's 3-0, TCU leading West Virginia. But the referees right now, Brandon Cruz and the replay official Don Capra, are looking at the previous punt And was this actually a touchback? Let's bring in Mike Pereira from L.A. And, Mike, if you could walk us through what you think the officials are looking at, and will this play stand or be overturned?
Well, based on Brandon Cruz's announcement, he said that the kicking team member controlled the ball, but he doesn't. He doesn't actually possess the ball. So you still have a loose ball. So now they're going to make the decision. Did, in fact, the ball break the plane? Did it touch the goal line there? Had it broken the plane before? But the one thing I think they'll review quickly here is that he never had control. So this is a tough one. To me, it looks like it probably broke the plane, either initially or on that bounce and may have touched. But they're going to have to conclude as we get Brandon's announcement coming.
For West Virginia, never controlled the ball. The ball became dead after it broke the plane of the goal line. Therefore, the result of the play is a touchback. Ball will be placed at the 20-yard line. First down, TCU.
And that's why Brandon Cruz and Don Capral, you know, been together all year long. They got past that. They did conclude he didn't have possession. And then you could see it was close, but the ball broke the plane maybe twice. So it was a good ruling to rule it a touchback and put the ball at the 20.
Yeah, and that's a big play right there. It's a difference of being pinned back by your own end zone or being at the 20 here for Mike Collins and the offense for TCU. Mike, thank you very much as always. Great job explaining it. On first down, that's a lateral loose ball. And that is covered up by Tay Barber, the true freshman. But that's a big loss for TCU, a loss of 12.
Those are the hardest passes to throw as a quarterback. Swing routes, because you really don't work on them as much as you like on other routes. But you see Collins here, he has to put the ball on his front numbers. And that time it was just on that low hip. You got to put it out in front of him so the receiver can continue to run. And that time Tay Barber was fortunate to get back on that ball. Could have been a huge disaster for TCU's offense.
Looked like he had a little something developing out there on the edge. Was he able to control that ball?
Second down and 22 now. Collins on the slant, able to complete that pass to Jalen Reagor. And Reagor, he gets 12, third and 10 coming up.
Great catch by Reagor, just plucking that slant out of the air. It was coming a little hot and fast there, but Reagor, sophomore, is one of their best receivers, by far. One touchdown catch in the last four games, as Petros alluded to earlier, but they have to get him going. Third down, look for Reagor.
Third and 10. You just saw Gary Patterson, one of the best in the game. 18th year here at TCU. And there is movement on both sides of the ball. The question's going to be who jumped first.
I might say that he was drawn.
Mm-hmm.
Offside, defense, number 11 went into the neutral zone, caused a reaction by the offense, 5-yard penalty.
That's against David Long,
rare mistake,
leader of this defense. Tony Gibson looking on, so that now goes to a third and 5 situation here for TCU. You think about how this whole drive started. It could have been first and 10 from their own 1. Instead, the play got overturned. It was first and 10 from the 20. A loss of 12 on a lateral. And now you're looking at a third and 5. Collins on third and 5. Throws, and he completes that pass to Jalen Austin for the first down. Gets 11.
Great job remaining patient by Michael Collins, just kind of floating out there and waiting for Austin to show him the numbers and find a space inside that zone. He was open for a little while, and after that first play, the lateral to make up that ground and get a first down, Tony Gibson's going to be very upset about that, defensive coordinator of the Mountaineers, especially the penalty.
So now first and 10 from the 36. Here for TCU. Barber goes in motion. Collins, that ball is deflected at the line. Second and 10. It looked like it was Jabril Robinson who got the hand on it, the transfer from Clemson.
One thing this offensive line does extremely well is they protect the quarterback. Only 8 sacks of the season, but you have to push these guys in West Virginia's defensive line, just pushing that pocket, getting in the face of Collins. Collins is a big guy, 6'5", so he can see over the line, but you have to get those hands up because he's a big guy and he has that strong arm capability downfield.
The handoff to Anderson. Anderson up to the 38. Josh Norwood with a tackle, 3rd and 8 coming up. You kind of had a feeling that this game for West Virginia, it would be a bit of a dogfight.
Well, you're always going to be in a dogfight against Gary Patterson's defense, and there's no doubt about it. You're going to fight it out. Guys are going to be covered. West Virginia's defense, an opportunity to get off the field here, pick up their offense a little bit.
Amari DeMarcado is in at tailback on 3rd and 8. Do they bring pressure? Here it comes. Collins, he gets sacked. Just the 9th sack given up by TCU this year. First one there was David Long. Remember, it was Long who was called.
They're bringing everybody. They're bringing the corner, a crash star. They're bringing the mic. They're bringing the sand. They're bringing everyone to get in the face of Gibson and not let him get comfortable. Talking with Gibson, this is what he wanted to do. Gibson, we want to put pressure on Collins, make sure that he's not comfortable in that pocket, sitting back there, and that's what you saw in that last possession.
Nunez, the low punt, line drive, fair catch by David Sills. 3-0 TCU leads, but Will Greer will get his 3rd chance at this TCU defense when we come back. Roots of the Roster, sponsored by Ancestry, give the gift that unwraps their family history. For TCU, 72 players are from the state of Texas. And guys, this is just the 2nd time they are playing outside the state of Texas this year. On 1st down, Greer gives it to Martell Pettaway. Pettaway had the big game last week at Texas. Picked up 121 yards on 9 carries, gets 5 here.
He played very well, and the backs are starting to come on a little bit for this team.
Greer comes near side, makes the pass to Jennings down the sideline, and Jennings with that strength able to drag Garrett Wallow all the way to the 25-yard line, gets 36.
He struggled a little bit with an ankle, but looks like he was able to get going forward here.
You can see West Virginia starting to push the tempo a little bit longer, but finding one of their best options on the outside, Gary Jennings, and just ran a simple out route, some miscommunication on the defensive side of the TCU. They have to make sure they account for these receivers.
Sills makes the pass to Bush. Tevin Bush does not get out of bounds. So the clock continues to run under a minute now. Arico Evans with a stop.
A lot of movement on that play. They bought Bush under. Usually that ghost forward pass that they used to run to Tavon Austin. They faked that, then threw it to him, and there was nowhere to go. TCU doing a great job in coverage, especially on the perimeter.
Sills in motion. They get it to him. He gets a block. And he doesn't get out of bounds. Markel Simmons with a tackle, but there is a flag. And maybe that block was a block in the back.
Great feat by Sills just to avoid the first tackler, but a good job by Juwan Johnson.
Block in the back. Yep. Offense, number 8. 10-yard penalty from the previous spot. It's 2nd down.
That's against Marcus Sims.
Marcus Sims, number 8 there. Right at the top.
You have to go. You can't go straight because you have to take an angle. That's why he was able to get that block in the back. When you're blocking on the edge, you always have to go at an angle. Go where he is.
2nd down and 19. Greer completes another pass to Gary Jennings, but that should be the final play of this first quarter, which means it's the first time this year that TCU did not, West Virginia did not score first, and it's the first time this year that West Virginia was held scoreless in the first quarter. On a chilly Saturday afternoon, the high-powered offense of West Virginia kept in check for the first 15 against Gary Patterson's defense. They trail by three. The Mountaineer, he was hoping to do a lot of push-ups today to stay warm. Right now, nothing. Third and 15 to open up this second quarter here for West Virginia. Greer stepping up over the middle, and that is incomplete. David Sills. Nice job by Julius Lewis to break up that pass. The stats from the first quarter. Advantage, TCU.
Well, they've played great defense, and they've really covered well. Will Greer does not really have a lot of options on where to throw the football. You saw there was double coverage, and he hitched twice. Gary Patterson's team playing great defense to start this game.
Yeah, they've held all 90 opponents below their season total defense, so this is going to be a tough game for West Virginia offensively.
The 47-yard field goal off the upright and in. Wow! Evan Staley, you don't see that very often.
Wow.
Watch it.
Wong.
Good call. 3-3 game. A 47-yard field goal into the wind by Evan Staley gave these fans something to cheer about. 3-3 game. Early second quarter. Justin Kutcher, DeMarco Murray, Petros Papadakis, Holly Saunders with you here on FS1. Staley will kick off. Darius Davis, Amari DiMarcado back deep. With the wind blowing, need a holder.
No job is important than the other one. You got to hold it sometimes, especially when this wind starts to pick up.
Trust the kicker. He will not kick your hand. Keeping it low beneath the wind. It's Davis. Muffs it a little bit. Picks it up. Gets going again. And a flag comes flying in from the backfield. Evan Staley got an attaboy for that kickoff because it is a strong wind. Let's wait to see what this flag is for and where TCU will start with the ball.
Both defenses played really well in the first quarter. Let's see if they can continue.
Holding. Receiving team number 80. Half the distance to the goal from the spot of the foul. It's first down, TCU.
Aldontre Davis called for the penalty. Mention the winds. It's blowing at 10. It feels even stronger than that. It feels like a balmy 21 degrees here in Morgantown.
Offense needs better field positions. This is their second time in a row having to start on their 10 to 11 yard line. Collins, he's only made his second start since K-State game. He has to have better field position. You don't want this crowd to take advantage over this young fella.
On first down, the handoff to Anderson. Looking for a hole, doesn't have much. We'll get two. Second down and 8.
You're absolutely right, DeMarco. This is a team that has to depend on their defense, but they also have to help their defense out by getting first downs and scoring points. You're not going to be able to seal up Will Greer and David Sills and Gary Jennings and all these different weapons that West Virginia has. Coach Patterson knows that. They need some production offensively.
Yeah, you're not going to go 90, 95 yards against this defense too often.
Second down and 8. The offense has really been Rager. Collins. Pressure. Gets out of the pocket. He's going to run with it. He'll pick up 3 as he gets tackled by Trayvon Askew-Henry. the most experienced player on this team. Most snaps in West Virginia history, Drayvon Askew-Henry. 48th consecutive start in the career.
I tell you what, Michael Collins is going to have a better plan going up against guys like Askew-Henry when he takes off to run the ball. Seems a lot of indecision for him when he gets in the open field about whether to slide or run forward or what to do.
Empty backfield, third and five for Collins. Collins taking the shot for Rager down the field, and that's broken up. Big time play right there by Keith Washington.
Jalen Rager has to make this catch. I believe he just dropped it. He's running a great route, runs a post, and it's man-to-man, no safety help, and he just drops the ball, I believe. Ball hit him right in the hands, but great job by Keith Washington continuing to play throughout that play. Thought he was going to catch it, but Rager just dropped the ball there. That was a great pass by Michael Collins.
Andrew David on to punt. David Sills back to return. With the wind behind, Sills' fair catch signaled and made around the 41-yard line. A 38-yard punt. First three and out of the game forced by the WVU defense. The Heisman watch is on here in November. Tua having a year to remember for Alabama. 27 touchdowns through his first interception last week. Kyler Murray taking over for last year's Heisman Trophy winner. What a year he's putting together. And Will Greer here for the Mountaineers.
His maturity is what separates him from a lot of quarterbacks. Having the chance to sit down with him, I was so impressed. Once he get in front of those GMs at the NFL level, they're going to love this kid.
Will Greer on first down completes the pass to one of his tight ends, Javonte Haskins. Haskins and Wesco, the two tight ends that he will target. And Haskins gets 12 here on first down. And again, West Virginia's going a little hurry up right here. Greer will swing the pass out and complete it to Kennedy McCoy, his tailback.
Well, going into this series, there was only two big plays that West Virginia had, a 23-yarder to Sills and a 34-yarder to Jennings. The other 12 plays, only 21 yards. Now Greer's got it going.
Delayed handoff here to McCoy, and McCoy gets wrapped up by Banigou. Ben Banigou, the preseason Big 12 Defensive Player of the Year, makes another tackle for a loss, this time of four. That's his 11th of the year.
Leads the defense in four categories: tackles for loss, sacks, quarterbacks, hurries, fumble recoveries. This guy is a big bowling ball, inside and outside, but he's going to be around the ball at all times. NFL prospect.
Letty Brown, the true freshman tailback, comes in. Pressure coming. Greer gets hit as he releases. And because he got hit, could not hit Jennings. LJ Collier delivered the blow. And let's check in right now with Holly Saunders down on the field.
Yeah, thanks, Justin. Well, during that last series, Will Greer took a shot to the right wrist, came over to the West Virginia sidelines where the medical staff checked him out. But when it was time to go back in and take the field, he popped right up. It's just something to maybe keep an eye on, Justin.
Will do. Will Greer, a tough kid, been through a lot in his career. McCoy comes back in now on third and 14. He goes in motion. Empty backfield. Pressure coming. Greer, and it's almost picked off as Sills slips. And Ardarius Washington, the true freshman, had it in his hands.
Right off the chest plate. And this ball was a little high for Sills. He goes down and then tries to get back up. It was actually a really good throw by Will Greer, but the slip makes the ball go right through Sills' hands and right off the chest plate of Washington. And another stop for the TCU defense after the two first downs. They buckle up again and get some pressure.
So Billy Kinney on to punt once again. Jalen Rager is back at his own eight. And this time, they will pin him at the one. It's Sills. No need to review this one. I gotcha. I gotcha. 3-3 game here in the second quarter. FS1 College Football is sponsored by Dave & Buster's. Eat, drink, play, and watch sports. That's what you need on a day like today. That nice warm hat. 3-3 game. But TCU pinned back at their own one. Mike Collins in the shotgun in his end zone with Anderson next to him. Fumbles in the end zone. He's in trouble. Able to get rid of it. Does. And he gets it to Shewo Olonato.
What a heads-up play by Collins. First things first, he drops the ball, then picks it up, avoids a sack from Bigelow.
Lua able to make the catch.
Wow. Doesn't just throw it away because you get a safety if you get a grounding. If you throw it away in the end zone, he finds his outlet. Great play getting out of danger there and making up a first down.
That's where the Penn education comes into play.
Smart only there play. For a year.
He gets hit. And they blow it dead. David Long again getting to the quarterback, Mike Collins.
Quarterback of the defense, David Long, Jr. Sees that he doesn't hand the ball off and just gets right in front of the way of the big 6'5 quarterback. Heads up play by David Long. He's the quarterback of this defense. He's the leader, a guy that can tackle, obviously. He can cover, but he's just their leader. He's a very vocal guy. He leads this team by example on and off the field.
And he leads the team in a lot of different categories as well. Second down and 10. Anderson trying to shake and bake, not escaping the tackle of Jovani Stewart for a loss of 3.
Jovani Stewart, 5 tackles for loss on the season. Add another one, that's his 6. He's a stable linebacker who knows his defense extremely well. Here you see him just keying the ball, reading the ball. He knows this guy can make him miss, but he's just staying put. Great base. When you're dealing with a guy like that, you have to have a great base because you don't want him to make you look silly. And that time, Jovani Stewart got the best of Darius Anderson.
Olana Lua is the tailback here on 3rd and 13 for TCU. What kind of pressure does West Virginia bring? They snap the ball. Collins wasn't looking. Trying to cover up. He does.
Collins, the center, knew that the clock was running out and they were going to get a delay of game penalty. Collins was trying to communicate with his receivers on the outside, and Hollins fires it right into the groin of Michael Collins. And he is really lucky that he was able to come up with that football. Just to show you how important field position is in this game, West Virginia is playing a real defensive field position game right now with TCU.
Andrew David to punt from his end zone. Sills fields it on a bounce. And he got a block, takes it across midfield. So good starting field position here for the Mountaineer offense. Can the combination of Greer and Sills combine to do something special on this next possession? A low-scoring affair thus far between TCU and number 9 West Virginia. 3-3 game as the Mountaineers take over at the TCU 49. Alex Sinkfield in at tailback. And Sinkfield breaks the tackle. Alex Sinkfield, who had missed 4 games earlier this year with a high ankle sprain, picks up 8 on first down. And that's their best first down run yet today. They give it to him again. He'll get a yard. It'll be 3rd and 1.
Talking to Spath, this is what they want to do. They have to be able to run the ball. We know they can pass the ball downfield, but in order to make the play-action game and the shots taken downfield, we have to run the ball. And they love running the ball behind their right tackle, Colton, and Trayvon Wesco. Those two are the strongest run blockers of this offense.
There he is, Jake Spavital, the offensive coordinator here at West Virginia. Dana Holgerson begrudgingly giving up play calling duties to him. He's doing a great job.
Well, when you have a guy like Spav, you'll give those away at any time.
Petaway. Let's see where forward progress is. This is going to be very, very close. Terrell Cooper, LJ Collier combining for the tackle.
Pettaway, 212 pounds, kind of their short yardage goal line back. They can get those strong yards, but you see here, offensive line, oh, he could have just sunk it in there when you're trying to go lateral and you guys are moving forward as a running back. Third and short, know where the sticks are. Get that first down. Don't try to bounce it outside because you only need 1 yard.
Okay, so let me throw this out there right now. In this game of field position, 3-3 game, the way we've seen West Virginia's defense play, if they don't get it here, and it's so close, they don't have it, do you go for it?
Hunt it again. You got Sills as a gunner. You keep pinning him back. It's going to give eventually. And this TCU defense does not buckle well, and it could take a lot of your confidence away if you don't get it.
I say you go for it. Knowing Dana and this offense, this is a great offense. They're one of the most lethal offenses in all the ball, especially in the Big 12, but this is your home. You know, going for it for a two-point conversion last week, fourth and short, go for it. Let's try to get this offense, try to get this momentum back on their side.
Well, Gary Patterson has called the timeout, so I love it. The two of you guys disagree right now. Gary Patterson's defense, Petros, is so good. DeMarco, you mentioned last week, they said, hey, we're going for it for the two-point conversion. It didn't matter, they're going to win the game. Now they're at home. This is a different ball game than last week. Why do you go for it?
Well, you need to win. You know what's at stake. They control their own destiny. In order for them to get to the game that they want, that Big 12 championship, you have to go to TCU, one of the best defenses in the Big 12 and ball in general. But when you have Will Grier, the number one player, I believe, hopefully the Heisman hopeful, I believe you got to go for it and get this offense going. They haven't had successful drives, but if you can get this first down and get TC on their heels, this will be huge for the ball game.
Does he keep it himself, Grier, here? He doesn't. He gives it to Pettaway, and Pettaway with a push will get the first down.
Scary to back the quarterback up and hand it off, but a really nice-looking short yardage play from Jake Spavadal's offense.
Okay, so you said it was a really nice short yardage play. Why?
Well, because they led everybody through. They got a good push. They got Collier out of the way. And first down.
And now taking the shot to the end zone. Dropped. David Sills had it. You don't see him drop many of those.
You won't see him drop many of those, but you know that won't be the last time that Grier gives him an opportunity. David Sills, they've accounted for 29 touchdowns since 2017, but they let the ball sneak up on them a little too late, and you got to reach for it when you're going to get the ball out of the air.
I almost wonder if he looked back up into the sun.
Well, when you have the sun in your eyes, there's an old saying, you have to catch the sun. You can't see the ball, but just catch the sun, and if you catch the sun, you'll catch the ball.
Now, sounds pretty big.
Play clock down to one. Grier, pass deflected. And they're going to say it's intercepted. And it is. Off the hands of Simmons.
If this is an interception,
Issa Haku is the one who came up with it. But let's see. Did it touch the ground?
Yeah,
I think it was down.
Yeah, I think it touched the ground. Great acting, though. That was an amazing acting job. Oh, no, he got up under it.
It looks like he had both forearms under the ball. Issa Haku.
Issa Haku. This secondary, they haven't had a lot of interceptions on the season. They've only had 4 interceptions this year. And if you can get this interception, this will be huge for this TCU team and get this momentum really continuing to go on their side.
Interception is under review.
That's an athletic play and a heads-up play. What awareness to dive and get both hands underneath that ball and scoop it up. But great job by Issa Haku.
And it is not coming easy for West Virginia. They have to fight and scratch just to get the one first down. Drop ball by Sills, which should have been a touchdown, and now looks like an interception.
Let's bring in Mike Pereira and get his thoughts on whether or not this will be an interception for Ridwan Issa Haku.
Did Petros think it was an interception?
Yes.
Okay, then I'm going with you, Petros. I'm going with you.
Thank you, Mike.
I think the key is
did the ball actually touch the ground? I actually think the point of the ball hits his arm and doesn't get to the ground, and then he gets control. So we don't see anything here back in our command center in LA that could lead to a reversal.
So Mike is going to go with Petros here. He believes the call will not just stand, but maybe even be confirmed.
And it just goes to show you almost every throw is contested. Everybody is covered up. And the Horned Frogs do a great job rallying to the football. This has been a defense decimated by injury, and they are playing great.
Despite all the injuries to their key members of this defense, they've continued this trend led by Coach Patterson. He's one of the best defense coordinators, best head coaches in all of ball. And I love his enthusiasm on the sideline. He's yelling, he's screaming. They know this is not the TCU defense or TCU team that they're used to seeing, but he's still coaching his heart out. And the players, which I love, they're playing and they're rallying and they're having fun playing this game.
The different guys doing different things, having to move around. They've lost so many safeties this year. Garrett Wallow had to move from linebacker back to strong safety.
On the field of an interception, stands as called. It's first down, TCU.
First turnover for the Mountaineers. And it's a big one. What an effort by Isahaku.
That's big time. That's big time for this team and this defense. You can't say enough about them, but both defenses, not just TCU, but West Virginia's defense, they're also playing well and keeping this game close.
So Collins takes over at the 28, the handoff to Darius Anderson. And Anderson will get a yard.
There's a lot of talk in the Big 12 about offenses, but these two defenses here in the Big 12, they hold their own and they match up well against any team in the nation.
That really is one of the differences in West Virginia's football team in the last few years is Tony Gibson coordinating this defense around Dana Holgorsen's offense. He's done a wonderful job here with a lot of different types of players.
And this is now a chance for his defense to pick up the offense after the turnover.
And they're coming with pressure here.
Second and nine. They come with the pressure. Collins gets rid of it at the last minute. Was there anyone in the vicinity? The fans want intentional grounding.
No this foul on the play for intentional grounding. Number 84 was in the area of the forward pass.
This is what you want to do to a young quarterback who hasn't had a lot of time behind the center and playing time. You want to send pressure, move the secondary covers, move guys around to make him account and get his mind off his targets. And Coach Gibson, he's done an unbelievable job in making sure that he's not comfortable mentally. If you hit him with the ball, without the ball, that's going to get him off his game just enough.
That was awfully generous for Cole Novak being in the vicinity. He didn't know where the ball was. He was still blocking. Second and third and nine now. Pressure again. No flag. The intended receiver, Jaylen Austin, there on the coverage was Hakeem Bailey. So the defense does the job.
Here's Hakeem Bailey on the coverage, one-on-one. Gives a little ground and then makes a little contact early, but Austin trying to act there.
Yeah, it wasn't a really solid route by Austin. Austin has to come flat. He kind of rolled his route at the top. You have to come in crisp and hard at the top to give Collins the right away from throw.
Nunez punts. We'll be down inside the 25-yard line. 6:32 to go here in the first half. Still a 3-3 game. West Virginia. They are in a battle with TCU. Taking over at their own 24. Greer on first down. Stepping up in the pocket, delivers a strike to Gary Jennings. And Jennings up to the 30, gets six.
TCU flipped the field a little bit here on West Virginia. This is some of the worst field position they've had in a little bit of a while, and they were not able to do anything when they were right on the 50.
Now, if you're TCU's defense, this is what you want them to do. Go long. You can't have them go short drives.
They get it to Kennedy McCoy out of the backfield. McCoy gets the first down. As far as what has happened thus far for West Virginia, not exactly what you would expect from this potent offense. A team that averages almost 492 yards per game, 12th in the country. And that's to Sills down the sideline. And Sills is down at the 44 as he gets 17.
That was a great play call. A combo route with Gary Jennings and David Sills. Jennings keeps going and Sills comes underneath. Nice throw by Will Greer.
It's almost not fair. I mean, those two guys combine on a route. And now they get it to Sills again, and that's a good open field tackle made by Isahaku, who had that interception on the previous drive. 11-yard completion to Sills.
Greer sees everything. He sees the corner crash on that last one and knows that his first option, Sills, is wide open. Just sprints it out to him there on that ball.
McCoy has a hole, cuts it back. McCoy to the end zone. Touchdown, 33 yards. It's the run game that opens up the pass game. It was the pass game that opened up the run game.
And this is what you want. Kennedy McCoy, he's separating himself from the other backs. It was kind of a running back by committee, but now he's the guy. He's the future guy that they want to get the ball in his hands and let him get hot, let him get comfortable like they saw a week ago. If the hot hand is rolling, which Kennedy McCoy has now, he's going to continue to get more and more opportunities, and he leads this team with 5.7 yards per carry. Great open field stick there to get that 6 points.
Staley's extra point is good. McCoy had 5 yards before that rush. 33 on that one carry.
Great job by the offensive line and running behind that right side. Colton and Trevin Wesco, that's what they want to do. Talking to Coach Babb, this offensive line, they've been dominant in the run game as of late. And Kennedy McCoy, junior running back, 6 foot, 205 pounds, makes a great open field cut. And that's the kind of cut that me and Petros are used to seeing right there from ourselves as well.
I was more of a stilted runner.
You would probably ran him over. You would have ran him over.
Nice stuff from the running back committee that we were talking about from West Virginia. It's funny, you know, they had a freshman in Alex Sinkfield who was really the guy who they thought was going to be the starter going into the season, and now he's about third or fourth. They have two freshmen in Brown and Sinkfield playing, but that was a great run by McCoy. He's going to earn him a lot more carries.
Evan Staley on to kick off into the wind. Tay Barber is back deep for TCU. You can see that wind wreaking havoc. That's a live ball as Barber tries to cover up. It's still loose, still loose. And West Virginia is able to recover, it looks like. Was that really David Long recovering?
I wouldn't be shocked if it was. He could do it all.
Ruling on the field is the loose ball was recovered by the kicking team. First down, West Virginia.
Wow. Dash for that ball. What a crazy sequence here.
As a kick returner, you have to feel the ball. You can't allow that ball to bounce because you never know where it's going to go. Right, left, up. You have to recover. That's why they got you back there. And Tay Barber has to catch that ball. And they did a great job at putting that ball in the air, letting the kickoff team get going downhill. But excellent job there, just a heads-up play by the special teams.
That was X-ray low. David Long was in that scrum to keep it free. X-ray low recovered it. So now you talk about great starting field position in the 17. Do you take a shot here to Sills? Greer. Dumps it out to Sims. And Sims spins forward up to the 10, gets 7.
Greer felt the pressure on his backside from Collier and got that ball out pretty quickly. And now they're playing fast.
McCoy. He has enough for the first down. It'll be first and goal. Collier with a tackle.
Now you see West Virginia. They're not substituting. They're not giving TCU time to substitute and get rid. They're trying to push this tempo because they know that's at their advantage.
Sills drops another one in the back of the end zone. That's two.
Wow.
Not a good time of year for David Sills to get a case of the drops for West Virginia. Two touchdown passes, like you said, Justin, that were in his hands. Well thrown by Will Grier. Went right through the hands, and there's Greer's reaction.
I can't believe it.
Yeah, he doesn't usually have body language like that.
Martell Pettaway in on second down and goal. They give it to Pettaway. Pettaway, second effort, getting the push. And with that push, he takes it down to the one. It's going to be third and goal from the one. Juwan Johnson makes the stop. And I'm going to throw this out right now. Is this two down territory here for the Mountaineers?
But you never know with Coach Spav and Coach Hogerson. I mean, knowing these guys in the they have the momentum right now. If they can get another score before halftime, I don't see why this isn't four down territory for this offense.
It's Pettaway. Touchdown. They don't need four downs.
You can only ask so much of the Horned Frogs defense. They've been doing a great job all half. Been out there a lot, but their offense unable to get a lot going. Tony Gibson's guys doing a great job on the other side. And now Will Grier starting to get it going, being picked up by his defense. This offense looks lubed up.
Picked up by the defense and picked up by that running game. You go back to that last drive. Kenny McCoy with that explosive run. And then the defense had a big play there, or the special teams had a big play. But it's been the run game, and you have to catch the ball if you're David Sills. I know you get the touchdown, but you have to catch those balls.
The officials are just confirming that it was, in fact, a touchdown for Martell Pettaway. He had two last week against Texas when he went nine carries, 121 yards, including a 55-yard touchdown. And now the extra point for Evan Staley. This all started with that kickoff, the recovery, third and goal from the one, Pettaway. Gets in, and now they're starting to feel it here in Morgantown. Pettaway sporting the balaclava, as we educated DeMarco earlier today about that.
Ski mask, that's a ski mask.
It's a balaclava.
Never heard of it.
Doesn't matter. They're now leading 17-3. Staley to kick off. Let's see if they try to keep it short again. Into the wind. Fair catch is signaled. And it's made by DeMarco. Time for a Dave & Buster's game break. Let's go to L.A. and check in with Greg Wolf.
Justin, thanks. Rematch of the 2016 Big Ten Championship game at Beaver Stadium between Wisconsin and number 20 Penn State. After a Badgers touchdown, Nittany Lions answer very next series. Trace McSorley to DeAndre Tompkins' 14-yard score. They've added another since. They lead 16-7 second quarter. Justin, DeMarco Petros, back to you.
All right, thank you very much, Greg. Well, let's see how TCU can respond. They do get the kickoff to open up the third quarter. But Mike Collins has been bottled up recently by this defense. On first down, nice play call. Tate Parber will get eight on first down. The true freshman came in during the spring, and his coach said he never blinked an eye. Workouts, everything. Mature kid. Stanford was looking at him. First drive, TCU looked great. The last four drives, West Virginia's defense has looked great. On second and two, Anderson He's going to get tackled for a loss by guess who?
Makes every tackle. That's what Dana Holgorsen told us. David Long with another great play. This is a huge third down. West Virginia has three timeouts, and the TCU defense is beat up. They need to get into the locker room. This is a giant third down just for the Horned Frogs to hang on to the ball, not give it back to Will Grier.
Look for some underneath routes. They run a lot of double slants, double under routes to get Collins the ball, get Collins very comfortable. They're not going to take a shot downfield here.
Alana Lua in the backfield on third and four. Collins over the middle. It's dropped by Rager. Would have been a first down. So some surprises. A drop there by Rager. We've seen two drops in the end zone by Sills.
Three big-time receivers in this game, Justin, and three drops between two of them. That's the first one from Rager. Really the second, if you think about the long pass that went off his hands, too. This has been a rough day out in the cold for these elite players on the perimeter.
Third, three and out in the last four possessions for TCU. This takes a TCU bounce. Sills says get away. It'll be down there on the 35-yard line of West Virginia. So if you're joining us late, West Virginia, they got going late. Kennedy McCoy, a 33-yard touchdown run. And then into the wind, the muff kick recovered by West Virginia. And the Mountaineers are able to punch it in from 1 yard out with Martell Pettaway. And they lead now 17-3. Three timeouts, P, as you had mentioned, with 2:13 to go for Will Grier and a chance to really put a stranglehold on this game because, frankly, TCU has struggled for a long time to score. Grier dumps it off to Pettaway. And Pettaway will take it across midfield.
Grier's so smart. His pre-snap mechanics, just he knows that's his hot option. Get the ball out of my hands. Let me turn to the flat because they brought four strong there.
Pettaway. Martell Pettaway. You can see this defense is starting to show its fatigue.
Yeah, and exactly what Jake Spavadal wants to do is run the ball and make them more tired, make them tackle these backs, get fresh legs into the game.
Incomplete pass to Long, and one of the in-game adjustments we've seen here from West Virginia, DeMarco, you mentioned it on the last drive, they've been going fast, not allowing for substitutions, not allowing for Gary Patterson's genius defensive mind to make those adjustments.
That all goes back to Will Grier. They have so much confidence in him. Hey, let's have Will Grier go out there, stay out there. He can call the play, so they give him a lot of room to make adjustments in-game and during plays.
Grier, the pump fake, wide open, tight end, Wesco, touchdown, 32 yards. The West Virginia boys scored a touchdown here in Morgantown, and these fans love it.
They love him, hometown hero. He's done a great job as blocking. He's been a guy that was 220 when he first got here. Now he's at 274 pounds, but he can still run there. You saw they do the pump fake, and they send him on the go route wide open. Great call by Coach Spav, and great decision by Grier there.
Staley on for the extra point. 24 points all in the quarter for West Virginia. Remember, they were held scoreless for the first time this year in the opening quarter.
You can only do so much against this offense when your offense isn't doing anything. And down the stretch here in the half, and Wesco has earned that long touchdown. He's done a lot of hard work in the trenches with blocking. And he gets rewarded. That's a big tight end now, 280 pounds.
That is a big tight end. I would love to run up behind him. Wow.
That's one of the things that Dana Holgorsen has really changed. He's gotten a lot of fullbacks and tight ends from inside the state. Those are players that he didn't use that much as an offensive guy with the other schools that he coached for, but he understood the importance of getting hometown guys that excite the crowd here in West Virginia and finding out what they can do well and developing the offense a little bit around them. You'd think the ball would just freeze to the tee at this point.
Fair catch is made at the 7-yard line by DeMarcado. Time for a Dave and Buster's game break. Let's go to LA and check in again with Greg Wolf.
All right, Justin, thanks. Over on Fox, number 10 Ohio State hasn't lost at Spartan Stadium since 1999. Dwayne Haskins, the little flip to Paris Campbell. It's the first score in the game. Buckeyes lead number 18 Michigan State 7-0 just before halftime. Justin, DeMarco Petros, back to you.
Well, they are dancing now in Morgantown. Dana Holgorsen's team leading 24-3 with 1:39 to go. And it has been a dominant, dominant second quarter for the Mountaineers. Collins pumps. Now he's going to run, running for his life. Tell you what, did a nice job staying on his feet, avoiding some big hits, gets 6 yards. Does the sophomore from New Canaan, Connecticut. The State Farm Halftime Show coming up next. Mike Hill and Matt Leiner, they are standing by. Collins to Anderson out of the backfield. Anderson gets wrestled to the ground by Keith Washington.
Great decision by Collins just to drop it down, find your check down, and get it to Anderson. Get the first down, keep the chains moving.
And you've got the wind behind you. Maybe you can get a score before halftime.
Absolutely. Got two timeouts left and a situation where you're starting to play fast and see what you can get. Would have helped there if Olanolua would have gotten out of bounds.
It got me once too. Collins trying to get out of bounds. He does. Also picks up the first down.
Collins is playing well. The team, they haven't helped them, the receivers, because they've had a couple drops. When you're dealing with a quarterback who hasn't had a lot of time, as receivers, as athletes, you have to make him comfortable by getting the ball and making defenders miss and getting him yards. So you have to help him out. But Collins, he's playing well.
Substitutions here for West Virginia defensively. 22 seconds to go here in the first half. Collins forced out of the pocket. On the run, throws incomplete. Rager was the closest receiver. 12 seconds to go here in the half.
It's great coverage there by this secondary. Nowhere to go, only rushing three down linemen. They're dropping eight, playing some soft man on the backside, but he just had nowhere to throw the ball. There you see Askew Henry just playing amazing man-to-man technique there.
On second and 10, hits his crossing receiver Darius Davis, and then Davis just got leveled as he came across the field. A timeout is taken.
This is the second timeout of the half for TCU. It'll be 30 seconds. Please set the clock.
Shivani Stewart delivered that big hit. We showed you the standings when we first came on the air today about why this game is so important for the Mountaineers. Well, they're 5-1 in conference play. They've got Oklahoma State and Oklahoma remaining during the regular season. They have a chance. They knew how tough this November would be. They took care of week one last week in Austin. Now you're playing TCU here. It's one game at a time, but Dana Holgorsen, he knew what he had this year with this team, a senior-laden team, a veteran-laden group, and a quarterback who's a Heisman candidate. Collins, incomplete, and that will do it for the first half. As West Virginia has scored 24 unanswered to lead 24-3 at the half over TCU. Let's get you now to L.A. for the State Farm Halftime Show. Appropriate song for West Virginia as they have been getting better as this day is going on. They lead 24-3 over TCU. Justin Kutcher alongside DeMarco Murray and Petros Papadakis. Not a great start for the Mountaineers. Held scoreless for the first time this year in the first quarter. But DeMarco, the second quarter, they got things rolling.
Yeah, the first five drives, no touchdowns. The last three jump started by Kenny McCoy's long run. And that's what got this offense going in the tempo of West Virginia. They forced TCU secondary to communicate. And when they allowed Will Greer to, hey, let's call some plays here and there, that's when they took advantage. Great job by West Virginia on the last couple of drives. Again, points.
Petros, TCU, they look good to open up the game. Settled for a field goal. Defensively were strong. It just looked like they got tired.
Well, West Virginia's defense really did a great job of stopping TCU from getting first downs, allowing their offense to get into a rhythm against a very talented TCU D. You see the stats there. 13 yards rushing for the Frogs is not going to get it done. They're going to need some kind of big play to jumpstart them, maybe Rager, maybe something in the special teams, maybe a pick six or a scoop and score. But TCU desperate to get some offensive points going here.
Those first half stats sponsored by Dave & Buster's. Eat, drink, play, and watch sports. Luke Hogan will kick off here for the Mountaineers. DeMarcado and Olanolua are back deep for TCU. DeMarcado has a bounce off the shoulder pads, now has to cover up at the 4-yard line. Not the start that TCU was hoping for, but let's find out what Coach Gary Patterson and Dana Holgorsen were thinking from Holly Saunders.
Thank you, Justin. I spoke to both coaches, and as you can imagine, my conversation with Coach Patterson was very brief. He was very hot. He told his kids, we have to grow up. We played on the road before, right? Let's act like it. And as for Coach Holgorsen, he said the biggest adjustment they made in that second quarter was changing the tempo on offense. Playing quicker didn't allow the TCU defense to make adjustments on the fly, which is something that Jake Spavital mentioned to us yesterday, Justin.
It really was, and as now, once again, TCU is backed up deep in their own territory.
The field of play, time should have ran up. 14:58 on the game clock, please.
Well, there you have it. 2 seconds come off the clock.
Mike Collins, he's been behind the eight ball all game long with horrible field possession and drops by the receiver. They have to give this kid time to throw the ball and put him in better situations to start drives.
Collins on first down finds Rager. And Rager takes it out to the 8, gets 4 yards.
Really nice open field tackle there by Josh Norwood. Rager was setting him up for an inside move, and it looked like he was going to have a long way to go if Norwood didn't make that play. Norwood doing a good job really limiting the yardage on that catch from a great player in Rager.
Norwood's done a nice job at the cornerback position, making some nice open field tackles. Collins plans, throws high, incomplete, looking for Rager. Keith Washington there on the coverage, 3rd and 6, and this is the danger territory again for TCU.
Here you see Michael Collins has a guy open, but the pressure by Stewart doesn't allow him to set his feet and make that throw. He knows he wished he had a split second before to get that ball off, set his feet and deliver it, but just pressure by Stewart there allowed him to get the ball off late.
Do they come with heavy pressure again for West Virginia on this 3rd and 6, deep in their own territory is TCU. They're coming. And they get to him, and they force the incompletion as Collins goes down in the end zone. Dante Stills, the true freshman, the brother of Darius Stills.
Pressure again, and that's exactly what DeMarco was talking about. Michael Collins, not a clean pocket.
to deliver the ball to a lot of guys that are covered anyway. There's a late flag out there.
Offense, the quarterback was not out of the pocket, threw the ball into an area with no eligible receiver. Foul occurred in the end zone by rule. Result is a safety.
Wow.
Wow. How about that? So Dante Stills, with the pressure, gets credit with a sack and a safety.
Let's see where the ball went and who was in the area. Getting away with a hold there on Giovanni Stewart. There's nobody in that area. There's absolutely nobody in that area. And yeah, you mentioned in the first half, he got a break.
Novak.
Yeah. He got a break in the first half with Novak, who was blocking. And they said he was in the area, but they couldn't even get a blocker in the area that time. Another terrible start of a drive for TCU. In the first drive of the first half, they had 65 yards. Since then, they've almost done nothing.
Remember, this game was tied at 3 with 5:32 to go in the second quarter. So they have scored 23 points since then.
That speaks volumes to this offense. You know, Coach Bav and led by Will Greer, they've had some drops, but this running game that they have wanted to pick up and complement this pass game, they've done a great job with McCoy and Petaway of running the ball early and often and setting up that play action pass. But this offense, they're just explosive and lethal. You have to watch out. You can't let them get so many opportunities. This TCU defense started off extremely well, but the offense isn't helping them out much.
Kicking now from the 20 into the wind is Cole Bunce. Sinkfield from the 22. Alex Sinkfield is going to take it up around the 40-yard line, and that's where West Virginia is going to start. Will Greer, you're going to look at his numbers and you're going to say, wait, only one touchdown throwing? He could easily have had 3, because 2 touchdowns were dropped in the end zone by his favorite target in David Sills. Martell Petaway, 31 yards, had a touchdown. Kennedy McCoy had a 33-yard touchdown pass, but he had negative 5 yards rushing prior to that. It's McCoy and Petaway in the backfield to open up here. Petaway goes in motion, the handoff to McCoy. McCoy gets wrapped up in the backfield by LJ Collier. A tackle for a loss of 1 by Collier. And Collier's someone that, DeMarco, you like a lot, a guy who you think is an NFL guy.
NFL guy, you'll see this guy on Sundays. Athletic, big guy that can button press and get in between that quarterback's face.
And how about this pass, the completion to Marcus Sims. Wow! And that's why you'll be seeing Will Greer on Sundays, 46 yards.
What a perfect ball thrown by Greer. And Marcus Sims with a great job at laying his hands out late and making sure that he catches that ball. But that's a 9 route, a fade route. And Greer puts it exactly where the ball should be. And Marcus Sims makes an unbelievable catch there.
We saw that beautiful deep ball he threw in Austin last week to Gary Jennings Jr. That was a similar ball, just perfectly placed.
Sims is down. Remember, Sims was injured in that game in Austin. He has been fighting to get through practice this week. Wasn't sure what his status would be. He's able to get up, but he just made that big-time catch on a beautiful throw from Greer.
When you lay out like that, sometimes you can just get the wind knocked out of you by the ground or the football, and it looks like he fell right on the football, kind of knocked the wind out of himself. But really nice play, sacrificing the body and trusting those hands by Marcus Sims, the junior out of Bowie, Maryland.
So now it's first and goal from the 9 here for West Virginia. McCoy in the backfield.
Watch the signals between Greer and Stills. These guys have some nonverbal communication going on.
Instead, the handoff up the middle. Down at the 1 is McCoy.
McCoy hit that hole fast and hard, and that's what you want to do inside the red zone. You don't want to spend a lot of time going east and west as a running back. Here you see the offensive line opens up a great hole, but he just hits it, and that's what you want to do.
They give it again. The second effort, touchdown. Kennedy McCoy, second touchdown of the day for him.
And he really has emerged as their guy.
Yeah, you got to love the way he's been playing as of late. Coming in with 81 touches, 471 yards, two touchdowns. Add two more to that touchdown total, but 205 pounds. He runs so fast, so physical, like he's 210, 215. As a small guy, to be able to run in between the tackles, that's what you love. That's what you respect about his game the most.
Evan Staley now on for the extra point. You know, it's weird. It's cold here in Morgantown, but when you score touchdowns on four straight drives,
you forget
all of
about
a sudden,
it. You become
things
warm.
Start to warm up. 33-3, West Virginia leading. FS1 College Football is sponsored by Ice Cold Dr. Pepper, the official drink of Fansville. With Veterans Day tomorrow, a lot of West Virginia vets all around the world want to say thank you for everything you do for us. Words can't express the gratitude that we have for you. And right now, the Mountaineers are putting it on TCU here at home. To Mercado, the fair catch is made, so TCU will start at the 25-yard line.
Been such an adventure returning kicks for the Frogs. That's one of the better plays they've had in the kicking game.
And on the road, it's been special teams is where you usually have to make up for that trash. And you have to come into away games playing great on special teams. And today in the first half, starting into this third quarter, they haven't done that on special teams.
13-12 to go here in the third quarter. Mike Collins in the shotgun here. On first down, the pass is batted down and nearly picked off. David Long again. He is everywhere.
He is everywhere. Once again, the quarterback on this defense. This guy is smart. He's very instinctive. And right here, he's just reading the quarterback, guys, reading that ball, sees that it's pulled out, and he almost makes a heck of an interception.
You say it's instinctive. How much of it is instinct? How much of it is watching film?
It's a little bit of both. I mean, this is a guy that, like, once again, he's the quarterback of this offense, so he knows the tendencies. 3-by-1, 2-by-2, are they going to run? Are they going to pass? So as a middle linebacker, as a leader of this defense, those are the things that you have to know.
Jalen Reagor made that catch, 16 yards. Keith Washington able to stop him. Otherwise, he may have taken that one to the house.
They're going to need a lot more of that offensively with Reagor, but without the run game, it's hard to imagine Collins being clear in the pocket enough to do that, to come back in this game. They got to get the run game going.
Reagor, 5 catches, 77 yards for TCU. And there is Anderson again hit in the backfield. A loss of one on the play. I mentioned how this TCU team has trouble scoring. When you look at what they have done this year, they haven't scored more than 28 points since week two of the year. I mean, and now you're trailing 33-3. Not an easy task against this defense of West Virginia as they swarm to Reagor here. Reagor will get two. Giovanni Stewart, the first one there.
And he's played very well. We talk a lot about David Long. They've had Dylan Tonkery back in this game from an injury. But Giovanni Stewart has been very active in this game, too, in the backfield and there, tackling Reagor.
I thought Gibson made a great point to us. He said how, you know, last week at Texas, they gave up 520 yards. His defense was ticked off. And he said they play better when they're ticked off.
And we saw them against Baylor. They were angry after the Iowa State game. They were angry after the Texas game. And today they're playing angry. They're bringing a lot of pressure and causing a lot of confusion for this TCU offense.
On third and nine, trouble again. They blow this one dead as Collins is down again. It's David Long again. Let's just put it like this on like replay. Like, We'll make a recording.
You see Long just kind of figuring out what to do. He came on a blitz and then backed off and then came on again. This inexperienced offensive line that's very beat up did a good job of picking up that blitz initially, but nobody downfield for Collins to throw to, even though West Virginia was rushing six.
Sills says clear out of the way. Did that hit a West Virginia player?
I believe it did.
It did. TCU has the ball. Sills is trying to say clear out of the way. And that hit, I believe it was Keith Washington.
First touch by a member of the receiving team. Recovered by the kicking team. First down, TCU.
There you see, when you have a punt, you see Sills calling, Peter, 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 meaning get out of the way. The ball is coming in hot. Don't touch it. And there you see Keith, he just couldn't find the ball he was trying to get, and it hit his leg. But heads up play by TCU on recovery, and that's the momentum that they need. Great field possession for the offense
here.
They
needed a special teams play. We were talking about it. Yes. They just got one.
For Keith Washington, you hate that feeling. It's like eating a sweet candle. Ugh. 33-3, TCU has it. And there comes a flag. Rager was the intended receiver, Josh Norwood on the coverage.
Never turned his head around. When the head doesn't come around and there's a little bit of contact, you're usually always gonna see the flag.
They make a play on the ball.
And as we mentioned, special teams playing on the road, that's how you get turning events. And there you see they have a big special teams play. Let's see if they get this personal or this pass interference on the defense.
There's no foul on the play for defensive pass interference. The contact and the pass occurred at the same time. The result of the play is incomplete pass. Second down.
They pick up the flag on this one. You don't see that a whole bunch. Press coverage from Norwood against Rager, slaps him in the face.
He beats him so bad off the line that he recovered because he beat him so bad. But Rager, great prolific player there.
On second and 10, Collins.
Ooh.
It's his
Ouch.
Freshman, Tay Barber, who takes the hit from Norwood. Again, you could hear that up here, a 15-yard completion.
He said they were ticked off. They aren't playing that way. This West Virginia team did not like the way they gave up yards against Texas.
See that safety coming now. You have one-on-one outside. Let's see if he goes on the outside receiver.
They are going outside to Rager to the end zone. Touchdown. 28 yards to Jalen Rager going up against Josh Norwood.
Great job by Michael Collins. He's seeing that safety come up pressure, knowing that he has one-on-one with his best outside receiver, Rager. He beats him on the go route, puts the ball exactly where it needs to be. A little underthrown, but great job, great connection between Collins and Rager, and great mechanics by Collins in knowing, hey, I got that pressure coming outside from that safety. I know I have my best receiver one-on-one with Josh Norwood. I'm going to throw it up and give him an opportunity.
He saw it when you saw it. There was no doubt where that ball was going to go.
Jonathan Song on for the extra point, and for Rager with that touchdown, that's five straight games with a touchdown for Jalen Rager. And Rager also goes over 100 yards on the game. It all started with this, hitting Keith Washington on the punt. And it was capitalized with a touchdown to Rager. Jalen Rager, fifth straight game with a touchdown.
He's climbing the charts already in just two seasons, already number seven on career touchdowns at 14. He's a dynamic receiver.
His dad, Monte, played 9 years in the NFL. Short kick again. Sinkfield from the 17. And Sinkfield takes it across the 25 up to the 27. A return of 10 yards here.
Well, let's see if that touchdown, the special teams play on the touchdown, ignites this Horned Frog defense. We know they have the coaching. We know they've shown some real skill, especially in the first quarter, but have they been battered too much by this Mountaineer offense to take a stand here?
Football is a physical and unforgiving sport, but you rarely see teams deal with the kind of injuries that they've been dealt with. But Patterson, great defensive coordinator, great head coach, and he has these guys playing at a high level at all times.
On first down, the handoff is to Martell Pettaway. He'll get 2 yards. Ben Banigou with a tackle.
The one thing West Virginia has been able to do in their run game is slip guys into the gaps running the ball. Mostly, it's been McCoy. One thing that TCU has really been able to do is maintain a good push with their defensive line. West Virginia's not getting a lot of give there.
Another handoff.
Better push there.
A really good push there. The really push good. To the first down. Pettaway gets 10.
Left side of that offensive line, you can see they just manhandled that defensive line there, and you're getting that push by Kajus, the leader of that offensive line, and great physical run by Pettaway there, getting the first down.
Remember, it was Yadni Kajus who last week was ejected early against Texas for an alleged punch. Greer dancing around in the pocket now shows off his athleticism as he got hit by Juwan Johnson. Otherwise, he could have had a much bigger run there.
Ran right by his guard, Josh Sills. Josh Sills doesn't see Will Greer take off too much. He took off to win the game with the two-point conversion against Texas. Looked like Sills was a little surprised seeing Greer run right by him.
I loved what Sills said last week. He said, I was confident I could get 3 yards. He told his guys, block and stay on the blocks, and I promise I'll get into the end zone for the two-point conversion. The high snap, and that's going to be a tackle for a loss by Banigou against Martell Pettaway.
Banigou, another one of those great edge rushers we've been talking about. L.J. Collier and Banigou have really kind of held this team together by being out on the field. When you've had so many injuries in the back half, it helps to have two great ends.
Yeah, they formed a pretty potent pass rush. They've combined for 11.5 sacks and 18.5 tackles for loss. That's the leader of this defense. And in order to stop Greer, you have to get that push and that pressure on the edge.
Third down and 12. A fumble on the snap. Greer gets it back. Good hop. And he gets it to Haskins, his tight end. Haskins will take it across the 45, gets 7 yards back. Garrett Wallow with the tackle.
TCU got a little help from Matt Jones. You see there's a snap, some snap confusion on two of the couple plays that they had, and that's what you want. Big special teams play. Offense went down and scored. Now you get a stop on defense. Let's see if they can continue to capitalize and get field position. That's been the biggest key for TCU's offense, the field position. Let's see if they get a great one here at the start of this drive.
This is the first punt for Billy Kinney since 11:38 of the second quarter. Rager coming up to field it at the 19, makes one man miss, and Rager takes it as he crosses the 25 up to the 28-yard line. 33-10, Mountaineers leading here in Morgantown.
Welcome back to Morgantown. West Virginia up 33-10 on TCU, and we talked about the pressure that Collins was going to face, and man, has he faced it. He has not been able to weather this storm coming from Tony Gibson's defense, whether it's been Giovanni Stewart or Kenny Bigelow, the nose tackle, or the great David Long. That time you saw Dante Stills force the safety. Unbelievable defensive effort on the pass rush by the Mountaineers.
They take over at the 28, does TCU. Collins again under pressure, and Collins almost like running for his life. He'll get back to the line of scrimmage. Zach Sandwich with a tackle. You see the Mountaineers, what they've done here at home versus the road. Man, they love playing at this stadium.
I would too. You hear this crowd? This crowd is amazing here. This is one of the best football atmospheres that I've been around in a long time.
I agree. It's always fun coming here to Morgantown, to Milan Pushkar Stadium. The fans are passionate about their Mountaineers. To Anderson, David Long, another tackle.
David Long, once again, he's fighting off blocks. He's making the tackles. This guy right here, he's going to have a long, long career. He just knows the ball. He can slip and maneuver his body any kind of way he wants. You saw him there, just slip the body, get the tackle, another tackle for loss. David Long is awesome.
I love a linebacker that's creative in his rush. You know, almost like a running back, the way he moves around people.
Third and 10 here for TCU. Here comes the pressure. Collins looking for Rager.
Good
Excuse
coverage.
Me, actually, I was looking for John Stevens Jr.
Big guy out there. John Stevens Jr., 6'5", 215 pounds, just a freshman out of Louisiana. Good coverage by Keith Washington. We're all over him.
Good coverage. He's also got great genes. His sister, Sloane Stevens, the star tennis player.
Absolutely. He needed a racket to catch that one.
Short punt, fair catch is going to be made by Gary Jennings. The offense for the Mountaineers, they've put up 31. There was two from a safety. They'll be back on the field after this. And the Fox Sports app. You can also watch Georgetown at Illinois Tuesday if you would like. Will Greer here on first down throws incomplete. Intended for David Sills.
Jeff Gladney, the savvy vet, did a great job at covering their man-to-man defense, but he's coming off. He's not pressing. He's mixing up his techniques to give Sills a different look.
That's a heck of a matchup between Gladney and Sills, two of the best at their craft.
Letty Brown thought he had a hole. That hole was closed by Ben Banigou. A one-yard run for Brown, third and nine coming up. I give TCU credit. You think about the way this quarter began. A safety. They capitalized. Did West Virginia. But the defense, the last couple of series, have stepped up. Sills in motion. Greer with time. Goes to Sills. Has to make a move. Stiff arm. He makes the move. And they're going to mark him out just shy of the first down marker at midfield, and the fans don't like that.
Talk about having a plan. Sills is a guy that has a plan when he catches a ball.
Yeah, he comes in motion. He's the check down, running a swing route, a bubble route on the outside, and Greer looks downfield, another one open. Let me just check it off to my guy, see if he can get me that first down, and he does.
They're going for it on fourth and one, and they complete it. The pass to Gary Jennings for 6 yards.
That tempo, this is what separates them. They're not allowing TCU to make substitution. They're forcing them to communicate on the secondary because they have so many injuries.
Greer. The comeback route. And it is caught by Marcus Sims.
You get the feeling now Greer is starting to feel himself in this game. A little bit like the last time we were here in the game against Texas, against Baylor in Texas. He was just in control the whole game.
And now he's going to hand off to Letty Brown. Will Greer is at 282 yards. So you think about what Will Greer has done. This is his 20th career game at West Virginia. He has thrown for 300 yards and 16 of his first 19 starts at West Virginia.
Can't talk enough about Will Greer, what he's been able to do. Coming from Florida, having to deal with what he's going to marry, having a kid. He's a phenomenal player, phenomenal person, just so mature in his decision. When we had the opportunity to speak with him one-on-one yesterday, he's a very, very emotional quarterback.
I mean, look at these numbers, where he ranks in school history. And again, that's just in 20 games, guys. It's remarkable.
Some NFL team, they're going to be lucky to have him next year, I can tell you that.
On second and 10, pass over the middle. Wesco. And Wesco gets tackled at the 10-yard line by Markell Simmons.
You crowd the line of scrimmage on Will Greer. He'll hit you with one of those pop passes. He got Jennings on fourth and one, this time to the big tight end.
He was reading Juwan Washington. That's that run-pass option. If that linebacker comes up and takes the cheese on that run fake, just pop it out to my tight end, and there you see Wesco wide open. Great feat by the big fella as well at the end of that play.
Greer is over 300 yards now, 17th time in a West Virginia uniform. Kennedy McCoy will take the handoff. And McCoy will get a couple yards.
You know, DeMarco mentioned the way that Will Greer's career started at Florida. And you look at that and you look at this, and just what a solid rock of a player he has been for Dana Holgorsen and this whole offense, really getting these guys going. And you talked about him being an emotional guy. He really is. He emotionally gets these guys going. But at the same time, he's even keel enough to stand back there and deliver the ball.
Right. He's just fundamentally sound with great footwork in the pocket, strong and accurate arm. He's a competitor, and he loves to compete.
Greer surveying his options. Everyone's covered. And now Greer's going to throw it through the uprights. Technically, that was what, a 28-yard field goal?
No? somewhat like that.
Third goal. Gotta kick it.
So it's third and goal from the 9. 11th play of the drive here for the Mountaineers.
Let's see if they can't get Sills a touchdown. He has dropped 2 today.
Watch the hand signals, the eyebrows, the arm, anything between these two, the nonverbal communication, they're always on the same page.
The crossing route to Jennings to the end zone. Touchdown, West Virginia. Tenth touchdown of the season for Gary Jennings.
What a nice drive by the Heisman candidate, Will Greer. Really distributed the ball all over the place. You saw Sims make a nice catch, Jennings with a couple, Wesco, the tight end, with a big catch, and Jennings, who's been slowed a little bit by an ankle, looking pretty good with those strong hands in the second half.
Staley on for the extra point to put up the 40 spot. And that extra point is good. Well, take me home, country road. Will Greer has made a home for himself here in Morgantown. West Virginia. The band was quiet in the first quarter. They've been busy ever since. 40 points since the start of the second quarter for West Virginia, now leading 40-10. Luke Hogan will kick off for the Mountaineers. And the fair catch is signaled for by DeMarcado. Well, Will Greer has etched his name as one of the great quarterbacks in West Virginia history. And Petros, it's quite a list they've got together.
Well, Ollie Luck, the former athletic director, Andrew's dad, Hostetler, Major Harris, way ahead of his time, Bulger, Pat White, who's here today, and Geno Smith, who really got people paying attention to Dana Holgorsen at West Virginia when they joined the Big 12 right away with the numbers he put up.
Collins here on first down, a drop ball by Darius Anderson, the running back.
They've had the case of the drops, special teams, running backs, receivers. They have to help Collins off. There's no important time more than now. I mean, minute left, down by 30. You got to make these easy catches.
Team to go here in the second, in the, excuse me, third quarter. Second down and 10. A handoff to Anderson. And Anderson takes it up to the 28-yard line. What's impressive about West Virginia is that TCU has held all of their opponents up to this game under their season averages for both points and yards. And the way the first quarter went, you thought, okay, they're going to continue that trend.
And they were playing field position. I mean, I thought we were going to have a 9-3 game, but then we forgot Will Grier was out here.
Well, Greer's the big dog. You can't stop this kid.
Yeah, big dog's got to eat.
That pass is to DeMarcado. Gets tackled by David Long and Giovanni Stewart, who gets two. And that should lead us to the end of this third quarter.
Giovanni Stewart does an amazing job fighting off the tackle. They tried to set up a quick screen, but Giovanni Stewart right there fighting the tackle off and being aware of that quick screen, taking down that running back. Good job there.
Gary Patterson's team trails by 30 as we go to the fourth quarter here in Morgantown. We're still here, actually. Just kidding. We fooled you with that teaser. There is a timeout called by West Virginia. And the reason for that was because fourth down is coming up in a punt. And we've talked about the wind all day. Well, this punt is punting into the wind.
Very smart. Really heads up timeout by the Mountaineers for the field position in this situation.
And they have two men back and two very good hand guys back in Sills and Jennings to field this punt.
Heads up job by Coach Hogerson there, just having the awareness to call the timeout before half.
And a fair catch will be made by Sills. So in the TV business, we call it a tease. Now we're going to break. See you in the fourth quarter. To go here in Morgantown for West Virginia. And we talked about the gauntlet that has been November for West Virginia as Wesco takes that quick pass from Grier. And Trevon Wesco, the big tight end, gets 15, and he is having himself a nice game.
See the Packers do this a lot. They put that guy in the flat, then they have those two receivers blocking downfield, but Wesco's big guy blocking extremely well. They're giving him a lot of targets on today.
A career high 74 yards for Trevon Wesco.
Might as well be Mark Bravaro out there.
Yeah, no kidding, right? The great giant tight ends. Look at him getting the push to go forward. Matt Jones pushing him forward as he gets 10. Jeff yeah. Gladney with a tackle.
Nice pull scheme there. Yodney Kajust came around and laid a big block, and now West Virginia really starting to impose their will offensively.
Again, it's Pettaway. He'll get 3. But I was talking about that gauntlet of this November, right? Here they are, one quarter away from being halfway through that gauntlet. And this team has the makings of something special. But you got to close this one out. You're up by 30.
They're confident. Coaches, players, it's not a cocky confidence, but they're extremely confident in the way they play and the way they're led by their senior guys.
And how about that throw and catch? I don't know how Grier fit that in to get it to Wesco, but then Wesco shows off the guns.
Well, Wesco's got a big body. It's as simple as that, right in front of Evans. And he got that big body between Evans and the ball, made a catch, and then ground his way. Wesco's balling out there. And he does his little signature flex move, too. The crowd loves it.
Hits the hole up to the 18-yard line.
Now watch Wesco. We've been talking about how good of a blocker he is. Watch him block Collier. Now he's down there. Little fight for the ball with Pettaway.
Wesco's now coming out.
What a block. He had an unbelievable collision with LJ Collier to lead that play.
Letty Brown comes in. They give it to Brown. And Brown will get the first down. How often do you see a tight end essentially weigh the same as a defensive end?
Well, depends if you're Stanford, you know. But a lot of people really like this big tight end, and he's one of those guys that Dana Holgorsen can always find a spot for. He said that a body like that from inside the state, we had to get him.
Letty Brown. Up to the 9-yard line. And remember what Dana Holgorsen told us the last time we were here a couple weeks ago with this team. It's not as if he's forgotten how to run out the clock, but with this team, you need to keep that foot on the gas because they want to go, go, go.
It's something really about the way Greer runs the offense. They give him, we've been talking about it all day, DeMarco's been talking about it, they give him the keys.
It's Brown again, and he gets tripped up, but he will get enough yards for the first down up to the 4. Issahaku with the tackle. Ridwan Issahaku, who had the interception earlier.
23.
First and goal from the 4. Greer. Incomplete, no flag, intended for T.J. Simmons. Gladney there on the coverage.
And that was one of those little signals to T.J. Simmons. You saw Greer give him a little signal. DeMarco's been talking about it all day. He wiped his leg. Simmons knew to run the slant.
Well, I loved it. When we talked with Gary Jennings, he said you always have to be watching Will Greer because you never know when you might get that signal.
And that's what NFL quarterbacks do. You see them not looking at that receiver. They'll just give a signal from the backside, underneath their knees, just to signal that guy and make sure they're on the same page. There you see it.
And there it is, the touchdown to David Sills. You're waiting for that to happen.
He's had a rough day with a couple drops. They want to get his confidence going. One of the finest receivers in the country. Him and Will Greer, a very special connection and a special high five.
There you see the eyes of Greer. He's looking at that safety knowing that, hey, I got my number one target on the slant. Let me give him a signal. Puts it right on the money. Easy 6 points. Another connection for the top dynamic duo in all of college ball.
5 players with a touchdown now for West Virginia. The extra point is good. David Sills now with 12 touchdowns on the season. 30 in his career from Will Greer. That's just since last year. FS1 College Football is sponsored by Dave & Buster's. Eat, drink, play, and watch sports. And right now, West Virginia is crushing TCU 47-10. David Sills, look at that. In the red zone, find him.
I'd be smiling too if I had all those touchdowns in the red zone.
This will be taken by DeMarcado. And he returns it past the 25. Time now for the expectation-shattering drive of the game, sponsored by Buick. It was that last drive. The pass to Trevon Wesco. Letty Brown getting a first down, and then Sills. A little stutter-step move on the slant with a touchdown. And now TCU will take over at the 27. Collins able to hit Trevalence Hunt. And the ball comes loose. No whistle is blown. Back the other way into the end zone. Hang on, they are going to say the ball was down. Javonte Stewart ran it in, but they're going to say the ball was down.
And if the whistle was blown, that means the play is dead, but they could still have the recovery, as it was a clear recovery. You see the crowd reacting. Let's see if this ball comes out.
The ruling on the field is the runner's forward progress was stopped prior to him losing the ball.
Wow.
Very quick and fast whistle there by the referees. I don't agree with that call, but geez.
Here's another look. If they say forward progress is stopped and they blow the whistle,
it's not reviewable.
Yeah, it's over.
Big break. Should have been a fumble. Askew Henry's one who knocked it loose, but it doesn't matter. And now this pass. Another ball, this time is stripped. And the scrum for it. Keith Washington's the one who knocked it loose from Jaylen Austin.
How about Tony Gibson's guy still playing with a real attitude here in the fourth quarter, up 37. Still hungry for that ball.
Keith Washington giving some crowd there, and he comes up. Two interceptions of the year. He's trying to get that ball out. Knees down there, but heads up play by Keith Washington trying to get that ball out. But yeah, they're playing extremely hard and fast and physical today.
It is a first down for TCU. On the bootleg. The pass comes near side and complete to Jalen Reagor.
Man, can he create space for himself?
Yeah, just speed. You have to respect his big play ability. He's running fast and hard. Then he stops on a dime, coming back for the ball, and good throw by Collins there.
120 yards for Jalen Reagor on 8 catches on the day.
He's been their whole offense.
Collins has that ball tipped. It was Jabril Robinson, second PBU of the game for Robinson.
Very active hands, especially this drive by the Mountaineer defense. Still playing at a very high level, still rallying to the football. Michael Collins has not really had a clean pocket all game.
DeMarcano goes out. They swing it out to him. You just see a swarm of blue jerseys on every single play now. A 4-yard pickup, 3rd and 6 coming up, and you got to figure it's 2-down territory here for TCU.
And like we always talk about, usually that changes the 3rd down call.
Carter Ware's coming in as a fullback. He's the one who goes in motion. Collins. Pressure comes and Collins goes down. Gets sacked by David Long again. 3rd sack of the day for David Long. A loss of 6 on that play.
Kind of like Dana Holgorsen told us. He doesn't really know what else to say about David Long. There's so many superlatives. You see one-on-one with the tackle, beats an offensive lineman, Anthony McKinney, takes an inside route on a left tackle who's about 50 pounds heavier than him, at least, and makes another play. What a baller.
Now it's Adam Nunez on to punt. Because of that sack, it took him out of going for it on 4th. The fair catch is called for and made by Sills. Will Greer has been celebrating. David Long has been celebrating. It's happiness here for the Mountaineers. Fox Sports and Wendy's brings you CFB Now, hosted by our good friend Jenny Taft, bring you, the fan, the best of college football throughout the season. Check it out today after Ohio State, Michigan State on Twitter at the handle CFB on Fox. 47-10, Jack Allison takes over at quarterback, and his first pass to Tevin Bush. Bush slips a tackle. He's got speed as he takes it across the 40.
Jack Allison will love that. Coming into the game, you throw a little hitch route, and you get 40 yards. Jack Allison is the quarterback of the future here. Big kid out of Miami.
We saw Jack Allison against Baylor, and he was able to take one deep to the end zone, find Sills in the end zone. And here the handoff is to Sinkfield, who gets three. Alex Sinkfield, the redshirt freshman, also from Florida.
Jack Allison, 6 foot six. That's Justin Herbert size.
Justin Herbert, the great quarterback at Oregon. Sinkfield. I'm going to ask this question to you guys, since we've had the opportunity, the good fortune to see both Justin Herbert and Will Greer. After seeing both those guys, what's your take on their futures?
Top two picks in the NFL draft. I mean, they're going to make a team extremely happy. Their mechanics and their leadership is very valuable, but just the kind of guys they are, you can see at the teammates level, and they have so much enthusiasm and passion about playing the game of football, it's unheard of.
Third and nine. Allison over the middle. That is incomplete. Intended for Bush again. Well, this will give Billy Kinney a chance to warm up and take a punt. Rager is the return man, back inside his own 20. Low kick, takes a West Virginia bounce. Will be down at the 14-yard line. With 5:25 to go here in the fourth, the Mountaineers looking to move to 8-1 on the season. The hardest working player, sponsored by Duluth Trading Company. Tough, ingenious workwear, designed and tested by tradesmen. It's David Long Jr.
He's been all over the field, almost had a couple interceptions, six tackles, three sacks, but athletic linebacker, the leader of this team and the leader of this defense. But David Long, 219 career tackles going into the game today.
Wow. On first down, Rager makes the catch for 4 yards. Long, his day, it's now cut short.
Rightfully so. He's had a long day. Rest up the legs, big fella. We'll see him maybe next week.
Next week, the Mountaineers travel to take on Oklahoma State.
Tough environment for them. They're playing at a high level, though, right now as of late.
They go to Stillwater. And then they'll wrap things up back here in Morgantown against some team. DeMarco, who is it?
The Oklahoma Sooners.
And maybe if things continue on the trajectory they're continuing, Dana Holgorsen going to have to play those Sooners back-to-back here and then in the Big 12 championship game.
Absolutely.
That'll be fun to watch. Two Heisman candidate quarterbacks, two games straight, 8 quarters of that.
Get your popcorn ready. I'll be tuned in for that one.
Third and one, and the pass is caught. Rager breaks another tackle, and the ball is punched loose. West Virginia saying they've got it. It was punched loose by Derek Pitts, and West Virginia does recover. Rager is still down. I think he's down because he's just frustrated with himself.
Rager's an amazing player. Stop and go. I know he fumbled the ball, but he's been one of their best players, the best player on this team. He's given them so much enthusiasm. We know he dropped the ball there, fumbled there, but he's been playing great, playing hard, but he's a phenomenal receiver, a very, very bright guy, sophomore. So he has a couple more years to go, but man, he's elusive.
Yeah, makes a lot of moves out there. That time just a little too much air under the ball and a heads-up play by Derek Pitts Jr., the sophomore from West Virginia, Dunsbar, right in the state, coming to knock at that ball loose. But I agree, DeMarco, Rager's been a stud.
Time for a game break. Let's go back to L.A. and check in with Greg Wolf.
Justin, thanks. Over on Fox, five straight possessions. Michigan State started inside their own five-yard line and finally catches up to them. Fumble on the snap. Draymond Jones recovers for an Ohio State touchdown. The Buckeyes lead 19-6, fourth quarter. Justin, DeMarco Petros, back to you.
All right, thanks so much. Here it's 47-10. West Virginia, the ninth-ranked team in the country, leading. Over TCU, Letty Brown takes the handoff, gets 3 yards. You know, we talked about a potential matchup of Heisman candidates and Will Grier and Kyler Murray, and we were talking with Gary Patterson, and he talked about Kyler Murray, how you just can't contain his speed. If he gets outside, he's gone. You can't catch him. I wonder what his takeaway would be comparing the two quarterbacks now facing Grier this year and facing Murray this year.
I think it's just the throwing ability. Kyler obviously throws a great ball, but Grier, his pre-snap management and the receivers on the outside, he has so much help, and he's able to put the ball exactly where it needs to be. And he's running this offense with tempo, and when they get that tempo going, they're dangerous along with the run game.
Letty Brown just shy, bringing up fourth and short.
I really like this back, Letty Brown, 215 pounds out of Philadelphia, only a freshman, but he's got a bright future here at West Virginia. They have plenty of backs, but they like to play Letty to it, get him out on the field and let him feel the ball. He's their best short yardage guy.
Yeah, they're excited about him. I mean, he's the future of this run game for sure. Four touchdowns of the season, and he's a big, strong running back.
Well, they give it to him on fourth and short, and he converts. Let's take a look at the road ahead for the Big 12, sponsored by Coors Light, the world's most refreshing beer. Here's what we're talking about. Okay, so for West Virginia, they've got Oklahoma State next week, and then home against Oklahoma. OU has Bedlam today. Versus Kansas, then here. Texas, I mean, there is some madness that could happen, but if OU and West Virginia win out, it sets up an incredible matchup.
Yeah, Texas and Iowa State are gonna play each other. Wild in the Big 12, like always. If you play everybody, I like that.
Letty Brown able to turn the corner and get outside.
Should have stayed in bounds there. You have to know, a young freshman, his awareness will continue to rise as he gets more reps and more involved in the game. But minute 40, coaches are yelling, stay in bounds. You got to slide. Baseball slide there.
Situational football constantly being taught. Even in a blowout game, there's still a lot of teaching opportunities on both sides of the ball.
They keep it on the ground for Brown. He'll get the first down, and he does stay in bounds. Not sure he meant to. L.J. Collier with a tackle. Let's go back to Greg Wolf for a game break in L.A.
Justin, thanks. Up next on FS1, more Big 12 action as freshman sensation Brock Purdy looks to keep Iowa State rolling. They won all four of his starts, including two wins over ranked opponents. They take on the Baylor Bears to become bowl eligible with a win after just a one-win season a year ago. Baylor, Iowa State next up on FS1.
More Big 12 action. Thank you very much, Greg. Our producer today, Kevin Patterson. Director, Renardo Lowe. Our technical producer, Mark Alsmeyer. Associate director, Caden Pfeiffer. Broadcast associates, Dan Radoff and Matt Gossip. The handoff here to Brown. And Letty Brown will get stopped at the 7. Our statistician up here in the booth is Scott Lightman. Our spotter is Ken Trevor. As we are under a minute to go here. And a great job by this crew, all our camera guys today on a very, very cold and windy day, getting all these shots. Thank you to all of them.
And we knew that TCU was outmanned in this game, especially between the two offenses. And we knew they were beat up on defense, but West Virginia's got to be pretty proud.
Brown, that should be the final play of the game. 47 points put up by the Mountaineers against this vaunted TCU defense. And with the 47 points, West Virginia moves to 8-1 on the season, 6-1 in Big 12 play, while TCU falls to 4-6 and 2-5 in Big 12 play. Will Grier threw for 343 yards, 3 touchdowns, 1 interception. For Petros Papadakis, DeMarco Murray, and Holly Saunders, I'm Justin Kutcher saying so long from Morgantown. Let's go to L.A., where Mike Hill and Matt Leinart are standing by.
All right, Justin.